All right. Well, welcome everybody to the our this is a combination here. This is our regular heads seminar series, monthly heads seminar series, and today we're going to talk about our new data our data enclave that we put together, our new access to data. So we've extended the invitations quite broadly because the data opportunities are available not only for people that are part of the Hopkins Economics of Alzheimer's Disease and Services Center, but also available throughout the Hopkins community or folks that are, you know, collaborating across the community. So it's a broader group than normal. I see 55 participants. We've moved to a webinar format, which is a little bit different and how we typically do these things, but it allow for this kind of broader reach. So welcome everybody to today's webinar. So we're gonna open up the shared screen, but maybe before we dig in, we can do some introductions. I'll start. I'm Dan Polsky, co-director with Jennifer Wolf of the Head Center, but also director of the Hopkins Business of Health Initiative, which is a collaborator on building this data research center. And I'm gonna have Matt and then Frank introduce themselves as well.
Thanks, Dan. It's great to see everybody here today. We're excited to talk to you all. I'm Matt Eisenberg. I'm associate professor and associate chair in health policy and management. And on the Head Center, collaborate with the executive team, and in my role as, deputy director of the RDEC. So we're excited to talk to you all about it today. Frank?
Yeah, hi everybody, and glad to be here. My name is Frank Xu, and I'm an assistant scientist in the Department of Health Policy and Management with Head Center, and I'm kind of working with Dan and Matt to build this RDEC. That will be a great resource for health related research and also in HI related research. And very excited to talk about our work with everybody.
So we're gonna get started, but I just wanna say that we wanna make this as interactive as possible. And so feel free to use the Q&A function. Or I don't know if you have access to the chat function, but feel free to ask questions with what's available to you in the webinar. Sometimes we'll be posing questions to you. And so we hope you're at your typewriters and giving us some feedback because we want to make this as interactive as possible. We're going to kind of flip through different slides and different parts of our team here. We'll start are in charge of different slides. I think this one is mine. So we're here today to talk about the HEDS Remote Data Enclave Core, which is called RDEC, and the Health Analytics Research Platform, which is called HARP. We have these two names, and I'll explain why. Essentially, underneath, it's exactly the same thing. And this is to allow for a Hopkins-wide platform for data collaboration. Currently, the goal of what we're trying to create for this data enclave is focused on users of CMS insurance claims data. And it's specific to that at the moment because across Hopkins, there have been challenges creating an environment that can be leveraged across the entire university to use CMS insurance claims. These challenges relate to privacy and security needs to access these data, but meeting those security needs at scale for access for anyone is something that requires a lot of core funding and infrastructure, and that's something that we work really hard to create. In fact, Hopkins is an amazing place to do this type of research because so much data exists on campus, but often it's funded through research grants that don't also have core funding that allows to to build the type of infrastructure that we're going to talk about today. So we have this double name, RDEC and HARP, is because we have two sources of core funding. One is through the HEADS Center, and the other is through the Hopkins Business of Health Initiative. And so having these two sources of core funding allow for us to build at scale, but also provide access and support access across different research questions. So we'll have what we're building under the RDEC platform is handholding for new pilots that are asking questions related to ADRD research. We're building data use agreements that allow for just simple access within that thematic focus. The Business of Health doesn't have a specific thematic focus, but if you have your own thematic focus, there's an opportunity to enter this portal that in some ways can accommodate a much broader range of questions. So that's why we've combined them, and the real economic model here works best at scale. So that's kind of the conception behind what we're trying to do here, trying to explain why we have these two names. And so the other point I want to make about what we're trying to build is, in addition to there being a lot of places on campus where you can access CMS insurance data if you're part of a specific research grant, some people write research grants and use what's called the CCW Virtual Resource Data Center, or the, did I get that right? VRDC, I think I flipped the letters there. The VRDC, where you can pay money to like use the remote servers that sit there at CMS. The challenges that people run into once they kind of build their research over time is it's really difficult to train new people and build new collaborations, because every time you want to add a new person to touch the data, it like doubles the price. And so we're trying to overcome, the RDEC or the VRDC might be a great opportunity for a number of people, but not for everybody. And we're trying to handle situations where we can build collaborations and training. And it also creates a lot of opportunities to leverage data reuse agreements, since these agreements are university wide. So we'll go to the next slide.
Oops, sorry.
So what are we doing to make this happen? We're going to go through it here, but real quick, create and sustain hardware and software for a remote data enclave, like an actual server, to do the actual work. But also doing, we're going to maintain a data warehouse, data inventory. So it'd be easier to understand the data that sit in this enclave, but also data that are complementary that maybe sit in complementary places for the type of research that connects to whatever researchers are interested in that are part of HEADS or part of HBHI. So I think I made that last comment. So the RDEC supports HEADS related access, and the HARP is really, you know, allowing for other users that aren't necessarily connected to the themes that are basically HEADS can support research that's connected to Alzheimer's disease related projects. And so that would otherwise limit the access, which is why we have this wraparound, because otherwise we'd run into the same challenges that other efforts that are similar have run into. So let's keep going here. So what we thought we would start with, I guess we didn't really bring Lisa or Joe into our, so maybe let's do
example. I think I can do that, Dan, because I think I was the one who got the host in. So, you keep introducing them and I will bring them in.
Okay, so we are delighted to, hopefully they're there, but Lisa Ryder and Joe Levy are collaborating together on a project that a new pilot project that's funded through the HEADS Center, and we I've invited them to introduce their aims to kind of stimulate some connection as the types of projects that are being conceived that use the data, that use CMS insurance claims data. So welcome, Joe, welcome, Lisa, and I'm gonna turn it over to you to give us a taste of what you're gonna be doing.
Hi there, can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay, perfect. So thanks very much for inviting us. So I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Health Policy and Management, and the topic of our HEADS pilot project is healthcare service utilization and cost of hip fracture care in older adults with dementia. And as Dan Polsky just noted, that I'm partnering with Dr. Joe Levy, who's a health economist in the department, and we aim to compare healthcare service utilization and the cost of hip fracture management among older adults with versus without dementia, and determine if dementia is predictive of higher cost independent of standard risk adjustment variables. And for this project, we're using the 20% Medicare fee-for-service sample from years 2015 to 2020. And, you know, utilizing this data will allow us to examine factors that drive inpatient cost of care, such as length of stay, fixation procedures, and complications, as well as examining the healthcare service utilization and cost 90 days following fracture. And Joe, I don't know if you wanted to add anything with respect to the cost analysis that we plan to do or access of the data.
No, I think you covered it. I mean, we have access to this 20% Medicare sample that we're going to be able to kind of track patients over the life course and look at these kind of key outcomes after the inciting incident of hip fracture.
Thank you. For that, I guess I want to, one thing that maybe we can come back to you in the Q&A is like the how of accessing these data and probably best to do that down the road. So we might call on you later because the how, sure. As you guys are experiencing, is a little bit tricky because we have yet to kind of fully lift the new enclave. So we'll get to that a little bit later, but I just want to thank you both for putting a face to the type of projects that we hope to continue to build over time.
Sure, thank you.
And so our second example, we're going to turn it over to Frank and maybe pull up the slide again. Great,
thanks. In this project, we are looking at whether and how MA reduces avoidable hospitalizations among Medicare beneficiaries with ambulatory care sensitive conditions, such as diabetes and hypertension. For the first part, we have found that yes, the rate of avoidable hospitalizations is lower in MA. And the next question is how? We know that the main differences between traditional Medicare and MA is that MA have care management techniques, and also MA plans use provider networks to shift patients to certain providers. So we are trying to disentangle the two channels. And one important question along the way is the doctors MA patients are seeing, are they in or out of network in their MA plan? And it turns out that no one knows about that, the pieces of data that we need to answer the questions only come together in this RDAC environment. So with the data we have, we identify in doctors and nurse practitioners in the One Key provider database, and we have for each plan, whether a doctor is in or out of network, and we link them to the MA claims data we have, and we can come up with the percentage of patients seeing out-of-network doctors for each MA carrier. For example, in 2018, 18% of beneficiaries in United Healthcare plans were seeing out-of-network doctors for their primary care. So this is another example of how this RDAC environment may inspire and make new research opportunities and may make new research possible. And so
other direction.
Yeah, can we move on to?
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah.
There we go.
Okay, so hope everybody is excited and is ready to learn about the data we have and how to access them. We have restricted CMS data and are trying to keep them up to date. We also are working to establish data use agreement for CMS claims linked survey data and HETS and HRS to cover HETS related research. We also have several licensed databases that we can share among this community. And in addition, our HETS colleagues, MJ Wu, Chaney Fabius, and Jennifer Wolf have been assembling contextual data on long-term services and supports. And we'll have them, and we're called enough to tell us something about the wonderful work they are doing. And finally, we love to hear your thoughts on what other investments we could make. And next slide, please. So first, CMS claims data. We have MA and fee-for-service claims and also prescription drug claims data. Some of you may already be very familiar with claims data, and some of you may be less so. So please feel free to jump in if you have questions. And we also put a link here in the title to some learning resources, and you will have the entire slide deck, so you can click link and find some resources. We may also sponsor a claims data 101 workshop in the future if people are interested. But for now, we will be providing you a high-level overview. The MA and fee-for-service data are, as you can see, quite similar in structure, but one big difference is that MA doesn't have payment information. So to be accurate, MA is really called encounter data rather than claims data. And we list all the files and years we have, and the years in orange will be available in the near future. On the MA side, we have 100% for outpatient, inpatient, and SNF and home health. And the exception is carrier. The professional claims because the file is too large and CMS won't allow us to have the entire carrier file. And we have about 12 million MA beneficiary in the carrier file. And depending on the year, it's about half or to 65% of all the MA beneficiaries. And we also have all the beneficiary level summary file for everyone, which include their age, sex, race, and ethnicity, zip code, and their chronic conditions. And on the fee-for-service side, we have 20% files for all segments of the claims, professional, outpatient, home health, and inpatient. And we have 20% Part D prescription drug claims for both MA and fee-for-service beneficiaries. And please, next slide. And there are also hospice records for all Medicare beneficiaries. And we also have MedPAR for all, which include state level information on skilled nursing home stays and hospital stays. And we also have MDPPS, which is all Medicare individuals providers and their specialty and the main locations where they practice. And finally, we will also be getting home health assessment data for all Medicare beneficiaries in our sample, which would have rich information on home health recipients' living conditions and their functional status. And one thing I would like to really highlight is that all the beneficiary IDs in all these files are linkable. So if you would like to follow some beneficiaries across time, and even if they switch between MA and PM, you can do that in all the data available on our deck. And then I will turn it over to Matt to talk about access to CMS data and also some other parts of our presentation.
Thanks so much, Frank and Dan, for leading us so far in this presentation. It's a lot of data, as Frank just talked about. It's a lot of data available, which means a lot of potential research projects can go on with it. I'm going to take it at a high level, but also for folks who maybe have not worked with CMS data before, the DUA process for working through CMS is quite complex. So what a DUA or data use agreement does is it describes the scope of work permitted, right? So it describes these are the questions I'm going to try to answer, and this is how I'm going to try to answer these questions. Our goal as an RDEC slash HARP is to both manage existing DUAs and help you write DUAs if you don't fit within one of our existing ones. So I think when you're asking, I have a project idea, how does this fit into the existing framework? You know, we urge you to come to us, right? And if your project fits within one of our existing DUAs, we may be able to add you to that DUA and get you started on your research quicker. An example here is we've written a DUA specific to our head center. So our head center is organized around certain research themes related to the economics and services of Alzheimer's and related dementia. So if you propose a project that fits within these broad themes, or if you are a HEADS pilot awardee, you likely fit under our existing HEADS DUA and wouldn't have to go through the process of writing a new DUA. And these new DUAs can sometimes take months and months to get approved. If your project doesn't fall within one of our existing, and that's an example, our HEADS team, if, for example, you came with us with a project that's not related to ADRD, but it also fit with one of the DUAs we manage, we're happy to facilitate connection to those who manage that DUA and see if you can possibly be added to that. If you're proposing a new project, we want to support you in that process. We've been through this process of writing these DUAs, and we can help. And we want to support you in applying for a reuse rather than having to buy all the data again and use the data we already have here and help you construct a DUA that fulfills your aims but also serves kind of the RDEC broader community. So the punchline is, you know, come to us if you have a project idea and we can help filter you into one of these paths. The last thing I want to note is if it's often the case that a project idea says, all right, you've got in the RDEC some of the data I'll need, but I'm going to need to buy some additional data too. We can also work with you with that. And it's actually, that's a great thing because that's the way the RDEC is going to become sustainable in the long term is if we're adding more years of data and more data sources to it time over time, right? So if you come in and say, hey, RDEC team, I need to use all of these files, but I also need to buy some new ones, you know, you would need the funds to purchase your new data, but we would facilitate the use, reuse of our existing data. And we'd help you manage a DUA that leverages everything we have here in addition to purchasing new data. I'll also note that Dan's gonna lead a conversation towards the end of this presentation that we actually have some core support to buy additional new data. So it's possible, even if you need additional data, you may not even need the funding for that because we're going to be allocating some of our resources to that. So we'll have part of that discussion later in the talk. Dan, I see you came off mute.
Yeah, I was going to just mention a couple of the questions in the Q&A.
Yeah.
Himal's asking about MDS data from the nursing homes. It's something I think we have discussed, but you know, so I think that's just a great example of data that are, you know, extraordinarily useful for HEDS related questions, which would suggest that there are some funds that could support purchasing some of that data. But I just want to say, I think in one of the bullets here that Matt has presented, the best way that we can, it's hard to buy data and just predict that they're going to be users. So if there's someone who wants to, who knows they want to lead a project, but maybe doesn't have the funding yet to buy the data themselves, but they're willing to be a portal for lots of potential users, we're not going to buy data with center funds unless it can support the growth of a number of projects. We're not going to buy data that are, you know, kind of specific to a single effort. That would be better used for, say, you know, developing that through research funds. So we want to work with people to make these investments, and it's a lot easier to make data investments if those individuals are also willing to, you know, build new users. So I think MDS is a classic example of something where there's an opportunity, but it also requires, you know, individuals who want to support, you know, the growth of new users. And the other question, maybe it's a more of a frank question from Jody, would the DOA allow linkage of claims to Hopkins patients, like in a probabilistic way?
I don't know. Frank, do you know the answer to that?
I mean, I don't think there's a, you know, direct link in terms of, you know, linking to like electronic health records, things like that. But I think you should probably, you would be able to identify, you know, that, like, you know, whether they are seeing a doctor that's affiliated with Hopkins or they are, you know, going to Johns Hopkins Hospital. I think that you can do in the claim.
Yeah. And you know, but there probably are, you know, that my guess is for the project that you're thinking of, it would probably involve a new DOA or an amendment to an existing DOA if that was going to be added. But I think I have seen DOAs using claims that attempt to do things like that. Just we haven't written it into our current DOA. But really linking them, yeah, I don't know. We'd have to explore that, Jody. It's nice to have this conversation with you during using the Q&A. maybe we take it offline and see and explore that a little bit more. I see Jennifer's joined us. Do you have something you want to jump in, Jennifer, on this end of the webinar?
Oh, I was just invited in, so I...
Welcome,
yes. But I guess the one thing that I'll say is it seems like there's a lot of interest in learning more about the data sources, and I'd love to make a plug for our summer research workshop for early stage investigators and later stage investigators who are interested in HEDS, areas of thematic interest to HEDS. And it's a two-day summer workshop on June 6th and 7th, where there is the opportunity to learn more about the RDEC and as well as receive mentoring on building your research ideas. So for those of you who are interested in the HEDS side and the RDEC, we will circulate information about how to apply. And I'll mute myself. That was...
Thanks, Jennifer.
That was me. I allowed Jennifer in just for the moment.
And I see one other question in the chat. Relatedly, can we get NPIs, the Bridges NPIs for providers through CMS claims? Like, yes, yes, and yes, we are all about NPIs. And some of the data we're going to be talking about in a sec, we'll talk a little bit more about how to do linkages for providers of all types.
And I think that's one of the kind of big benefits of CMS data, Amelia, is the NPI linkage ability. A lot of other claims databases focusing on commercially insured populations, you can't do that. So this is a big boon for the CMS related research.
Should we?
Yep. So I want to talk briefly about two other really important linked data sources that we want to facilitate access to through the RDEC. And part of the great thing about CMS data is there are a lot of these long-running surveys that you can link longitudinal data survey data on folks to their actual claims and see their healthcare utilization. So there's two that are really key and used by a lot of HEDS investigators. And that's the NHATS, the National Health and Aging Trends Study, linked, to CMS data, as well as the Health and Retirement Study. As we've noted here, these can be linked to all of the same claims data sets that we talked about before. Now, the way that this data is accessed is a little bit different. So CMS has these rules. We can't house the linked data on our own servers. CMS has contracted out with a firm called Metric, and they've built this health and aging data enclave to access the linked data. But again, to facilitate access here, what we've done at RDEC is crafted a HEDS-specific DUA that is focused on our HEDS-related themes, so focused on studying economics and services related to ADRD. And so there, if we have new pilot studies funded by HEDS or new collaborators or new folks who just want to do new projects within this HEDS umbrella, it's possible that you'll be able to use this DUA, and that will simplify your access. You're still not going to access it on the Hopkins servers. You still are going to access it through Metric, but we hope that with this broad DUA, we've simplified the process a little bit. And the DUA aims are put right here. I kept kind of like alluding to them, but they're actually written right here. Our HEDS Center's aims are specifically to identify and quantify the range of ADRD care needs and related economic consequences, and to examine how social resources and the organization, financing, and delivery of healthcare services affects accessibility, affordability, quality, and equity of ADRD care. So the punchline is a lot of research questions could fit under these two aims. They're quite broad. I wanna make a plug just in case you didn't see it. Nadia put into the chat, thank you, Nadia, the workshop that Jennifer was talking about, which will be this upcoming summer 2023. So if you want more details on that workshop, please click in the chat. I'm going to turn it back to Dan now, who's going to talk some more about other unique data linkages that we do here on the Hopkins servers. On mute, Dan.
Yeah, speaking of plugs, I just reminded Nadia to put in the chat our happy hour this afternoon. So we want to, you know, there's nothing that makes me happier than talking about data. So in addition to this hour here, we'll pick up the conversation in person. I think the details will follow shortly, and we hope to see you later this afternoon. All right, so you know, one of the advantages of having all the data in one place to really leverage claims data, it's helpful to have kind of curated and well understood data sets that can be easily linked. And so what was mentioned earlier is, can you link by NPI? And absolutely, one can link by NPI. And we also have a lot of data sets that have a lot of info for each NPI. So the first one is my favorite, my personal favorite, VeriCred Provider Network data. Now it's called IDEON. So essentially, for every insurer, we know every NPI that is in network, and this is true not only in Medicare Advantage, which is a real focus of the claims data, but also, you know, ACA marketplace plans and Medicaid managed care plans. So a lot of, we have a Medicare Advantage data lab that's ongoing. If you're interested in joining our data lab and aren't currently a member, you can also throw up a little note in the chat to be added to that. So our a lot of our research team's work in the area of MA is connected to how we learn about outcomes and costs as it relates to which physicians or which hospitals are in network and not in network. So that's how we can build complementary data sets, understanding work groups that focus on these complementary data sets that can then be linked to these claims data. Another one is what's called the One Key Healthcare Industry Database. And here we have a license that has of this data set. It's a Hopkins license that has every NPI that's a physician or a nurse practitioner or physician assistant. So, you know, it's like a million observations, has all the kind of demographics and location information, specialty information of those providers, but also tells you which organizations they're connected to. So if you reorganize the data, it can tell you for every organization, the whole list of physicians that are attached to each organization. So it's an incredibly powerful data set, and we have access to that data set as well. That's something that we maintain through our own resources. There's also the American Hospital Association annual data survey that has information on the 6,000 hospitals in the United States, financial information, you know, size and type and things like that. Those data are purchased annually through the library, but, you know, like, you can also just connect to those data through our portal as well. And Jen, since Jennifer's on this end of the pilot, we were gonna talk for her, but Jennifer's worked really hard on developing data, contextual data on long-term services and supports. Maybe you can talk for a few minutes about it if you're on mute, great.
Sure, I'm happy to say a few words. I've been working with a group of folks, including Dr. Cheney Fabius, MJ Wu, Sophia Okoye, Jeremy Ballreich, Julia Bergdorf. There's a group of us who've been working for several years, really sort of thinking about long-term services and supports and trying to understand variability and geography in long-term services and supports. There's been a lot of an appreciation of variability in the healthcare delivery context, and there's been less attention directed at understanding the role of the home and community and factors that may affect the experiences of older adults with disabilities. So our group has been working to sort of develop a holistic framework that thinks about domains of long-term services and support environment, including social and economic resources, the healthcare and long-term services and supports delivery context, and the built and natural environment. We've been initially focused on linking these data to the National Health and Aging Trends study through the Michigan Remote Data Enclave, and we have a data use agreement in place with the National Health and Aging Trends Study to be able to facilitate this data access. And we've been building a library of related data that focuses on at a variety of different environmental levels, from the census tract to the county to the state, based on the type of measure. And some of the data sources are listed here. We're pulling from the American Community Survey, the Dartmouth Atlas. We've also, and I know MJ is here, has developed, put a lot of attention into thinking about state level measures, such as how rebalanced a state is and the proportion of spending on long-term services and supports that is directed towards the home and community versus institutional care, and assembling measures by state and by year. As well as measures that are more policy related, such as the availability of paid family leave, And Medicaid structure structural factors like managed long-term services and supports. And Andrew Jobson, who may or may not be here, has really been leading the way on that. And so this work, we've been focused initially on this linkage to understanding the experiences of NHATS participants, but there's been a lot of work in developing the measures and then also crosswalking across various geographic levels, for example, from census tract to county, to pull in measures of direct care worker availability and wages from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And this is essentially, it's a lot of work. And we, as part of the Head Center, our job is really to make these data available to sort of lower the barriers to entry. And so we're very interested in making these data available and more the sort of the knowledge in the library of the data and the linkages. So we also have a working group that has been working for the last several years, but we're opening that up to the broader community. If you're interested in working with us, we'll likely be forming subgroups to take on such issues as measures of social and economic deprivation and trying to make sort of assemble resources for those who may be interested. And I'll stop there. I hope I didn't talk too long.
Thanks, Jennifer. That's great, great. Okay. In the chat, maybe I'll feel free to provide thoughts and other data sets to acquire. I'm informed that we also have an ability to turn on the audio or something. If someone wants to speak up, you can raise your hand. But we'd love to get some input as we think about new investments in this space. Or folks that are willing to work with us to develop new data assets. Ultimately, you know, we've started with the CMS claims data problem, but in our community at HEDS and at HBHI, there are other, it's not the be all and end all, and we wanna kind of grow together and meet the needs of you all. So feel free to chime in via chat or turn it on or send us a note later. And maybe people want to donate data if we have their permission. Yeah, we can always, so one way to think about this infrastructure that we're creating is we could just be a list of data sources. And it could be like, if you have a data source that you think others might benefit from, we could always just put up a, either put on our website or, share the information with us. And the RDEC could operate like this, like, oh, you want that data, like talk to that person. That's part of the services we provide. I hear often from PhD students that have to be very resourceful to figure out where hidden gems of data sit. And so hopefully we can be a clearinghouse for that. So if you have data you can donate, we could throw it on our server, we could manage it. You could still be in control and manage it, and we could just be a matchmaker of sorts. Is there Ian, my friend Ian from Emory, is there a desire to possibly expand to other university partners? I think it's really hard with the way that licenses are written. It's very university-centric. And if you have some thoughts about ways to overcome that, be willing to talk. But also, there are collaborators on Hopkins projects or projects that are funded through our HEDS pilot that maybe go to other universities. There are ways to have people enter into this Hopkins environment that don't necessarily have their primary appointment at Hopkins, but it's not like an entire network. These are licenses that are Hopkins licenses and are managed for, for people within Hopkins. But so, but happy to explore things outside of that window. But I guess the main point is that we do allow for access for our HEDS funded projects, even if they're to some of our investigators that have their primary appointment elsewhere. What a great question. Okay, let's keep going. Yeah, services. Is this my slide? I'll do it.
I think so. Yeah, you're doing great.
All right, so I'm on a roll. We're trying to finish up here too. We got about 10 minutes. One thing is that, especially for CMS data, so basically there are services we're going to provide. And then the next slide, which is what you're all been waiting for, is like, is this going to cost me anything? Is it all free? So we'll start with services provided. We've spent a lot of our time and energy building a secure server, which is with our partners at the JHPCE, at the School of Public Health, that have all the technical expertise to maintain the secure server. And the piece that's been missing, even though that server's been around for quite some time, that allow for a CMS data is to include in the data use agreements and the data protection plans, plans around how people can access the data and how they can download the data. And that's what the RDEC and the HARP Service Center is providing with our partners, our amazing partners at the JHPCE. So we've bought our own servers that sit on their large infrastructure. And we will be, maintaining the, kind of upkeep of those services and working on user norms so that, people don't overuse CPU time and things like that. We also will maintain a list of the projects that are sitting on the server so people know like who's working on what. We can also, I think one thing that has been really helpful lately is people write grants to buy data, to buy new data from CMS. And we have the boilerplate that says, these are all the fancy, I don't even know the names of all the, the name of the server, all the two-factor identification. It's like this big boilerplate that we can provide for any grant application for any of you that are writing applications to buy CMS data. You don't have to build your own secure environment. We've built it. It's accessible. Service number two, we're building data assets. Really, most of the data that get purchased on individual projects and then can be reused under data use agreements. So it's going to, over time, become a very complex web of DUAs, existing DUAs that one might fall under through collaborative engagement, or new DUAs that get written for new projects that are very specific, or other people that are looking to build broad collaborations. We might support the writing of those DUAs and the management of those DOAs, but essentially if people have their own DOA, it's managed by the PI, but we have, we're building the expertise to make that easier to do. So there's kind of that second and third bullet, there's a yin and a yang. The data assets are there. We know the DOAs, sometimes the data assets sit there, but you can't just get access to the data unless you're approved within an existing DOA. So that management is a big part of what's new, what we're providing. Getting the, for new users, getting up on the server, knowing how the server works, knowing the right behaviors to obey all data security protections, that will provide that to new users. We'll handle deliveries of restricted data, support access to existing training. There's a lot of training that's already out there. We don't have to do all the training ourselves, but sometimes it's hard to navigate it and find it, particularly if you're just trying to get up to speed on this style of research, and we can point you in the right direction. So those are some of the services that we provide, but it's not free, which takes us to the next slide, our revenue model to support it. So right now it's all supported through core funding, through our generous funders at the National Institute of Aging, and our generous funders that are connected to the Hopkins Business to Health Initiative. And so the core funding is paid for our initial servers, all the work that Frank, Matt, and myself, and all of our teammates have been doing over the past 3 years to get to this point, have really been what's been supporting things to date. We're going to get pilots on there, new projects that are very much connected to heads as soon as possible under existing DOAs. As we start to build critical mass within specific projects that are tied to our research themes, there's opportunities to do cost sharing for the variable costs, particularly for pilot users. So getting things going instantly won't incur all the kind of, the full kind of ongoing costs of upkeep. The goal at this point is to let people know who are writing grants, dreaming up their own projects, that these opportunities exist. And then what we're building is a research core so that people who are writing research grants can build in the costs into their research grants in a way that is completely compliant with NIH rules. And to be compliant with all NIH rules, all users will face the same fees. So we have to come up with a fee structure that applies to everyone. And fees are set at a level that meet the costs. This is, we're not trying to make money here. And also we don't, for CMS prohibits there to be a charge for the data itself. And so the things that we bill for within the center are for the services provided for access and management that were covered on the last slide. So just to give you a sense of where we think we're headed with this model, and it hasn't been finalized yet or approved even, is that there'll be an annual fee to cover all these access type of services. It might be more in the first year, just kind of a startup cost. And this will vary based on scope of the project. And it could run from my guess is around $10,000 to $20,000 a year, which is very competitive against jumping onto the other types of services that are available. But there's also a kind of a running charge, just so you can keep track of your CPU time. And that might be this variable monthly cost that gets pinged to each project. So that's where we're headed with the cost model. But if people have seen other models out there, we're still trying to kind of nail this down, and we're willing to take some input on that too. I think that takes us to the end here. The timeline. I'll give this a crack. So we have our server. We're in the next couple of months, we're going to start to put data on there make sure it's working. That's probably through December. The DOAs that are written for the new server will be transferred over in January. We're still pending a couple of approvals from CMS, so we hope that doesn't slip. There's currently the folks that work on these projects. I really need to acknowledge Michelle Treib and Jerry Anderson. A lot of the data, the great majority of the data that are gonna be kind of form the foundation of this new environment come from the research projects that Jerry Anderson and the data server that Michelle Treib has run over the past great number of years. It wasn't really built for the number of projects that they've been managing, and they've been managing projects without core funding. And they've been doing just an amazing job. We hope to emulate their generosity and spirit as we kind of move from that environment to a more updated, more easily accessible remote environment. But I really need to just acknowledge their partnership and their generosity as we've kind of built this new environment. But the truth is we haven't really converted yet. All the data still sit on that environment, and we're looking for some final approvals to both manage a transition period onto the new environment and a period where we can test it out. Currently we're at a spot where they feel you have to turn the lights on overnight, but there's so many existing projects that are moving. We wanna be able to test it and make sure that the new environment works for everybody before we put everyone on it. I think that takes us to the end. Just wanna also thank Matt and Frank for their leadership and their time that they've spent on this. It's been just a tremendous effort to get to this point. and I'm glad we have so much interest from all of you who are attending. I don't know if we've addressed all the questions, but feel free to ask us any other questions in the generous 3 minutes we've given you. Can we use military data? We don't have military data on there. If someone uses military data and we can get DOA permissions to add it onto our servers, we would more than welcome it. Other questions? Well, we have a happy hour at 5 o'clock at the Residence Inn Marriott in East Baltimore, and we hope to see you all at 5 o'clock. Does the server, we have a question here. Does the server have GPU for deep learning? No, is the easy answer to that one. So we would have to build that out. And also I think our data management plan that's been approved by CMS, there is a possibility to build in cloud opportunities, but we did not do that with our approvals that we got up till now. So in addition to adding cloud type of capabilities, we'd also have to get an amendment to our data use agreements to be able to do that. All right, well, thank you very much. Have a good afternoon, everybody.